anniversary of military aviation was celebrated at the RAF station Uphaven, an historic site, for it was at Uphaven that it all began. The Royal Flying Corps was formed on the 13th of May 1912 and consisted of a naval wing, a military wing, a central flying school, the Royal Aircraft Factory at Farnborough, and a reserve. The naval wing broke away in June 1914 to become the Royal Naval Air Service. 4 years later, on the 1st of April 1917, the two were reunited to form the Royal Air Force. The Central Flying School was set up on the training gallops at Uphaven. Many of the buildings still in use were built for the school, and some of the visitors on this fine June day served at the school in 1912. What tremendous advances they've seen, from Morris Farman Longhorns to English Electric Lightnings. As the large crowd gathered to enjoy the celebration, Wing Commander K.H. Wallace amused them with a demonstration of his 70-horsepower autogyro, designed, built, and flown by himself. Kites were first used to get men off the ground, but for military observation, balloons were developed from the 1860s, culminating in the Royal Engineers R-type seen here. Many arguments have arisen as to which is the RAF senior squadron, because number one squadron was formed from the lighter-than-air company of the Air Battalion, Royal Engineers, and remained as the RFC airship squadron until 1913, while numbers two and three squadrons were formed from aeroplane companies of the Air Battalion. Planes such as these represented the first trainers. They were followed by the Avro 504 series, the most famous of which was the 504K of 1915, and it's often been described as the greatest training machine of all time. Over 8,000 Avro 504s were produced during the war period. In 1932, the Royal Air Force adopted the well-known Avro Tutor as its standard trainer. Today's basic trainer is appropriately a jet, the two-seater Provost. These Provosts are flown by the instructors of the Central Flying School. The First World War saw the development of the aeroplane from an instrument of observation and reconnaissance to an offensive and defensive weapon. A typical scout, as fighters were then called, was the Sopwith Pup, which got its name in spite of official discouragement because pilots regarded it as the offspring of the Sopwith 1.5 strutter. Throughout the summer and autumn of 1917, the little biplane gave splendid service on the Western Front until succeeded by its great stable companion, the Sopwith Camel. Exactly 1 year before the RFC and the RNAS were united to form the RAF, the Flying Corps had its blackest month ever, bloody April 1917, the month in which the Bristol fighter made a tragic start to its career when, on the 5th, four out of six belonging to No. 48 Squadron were brought down through staying in tight formation. But it soon became an excellent fighting machine when crews used it as a conventional fighter with a sting in its tail. The design was so successful that, in a modified form, it continued in service until 1931. The Camel's rival for the title of the most successful single-seater fighter of the First World War was the SE-5A, a product of Farnborough and designed by H.P. Folland, who was later responsible for a long line of single-seater fighters for the Royal Air Force produced by the Gloucester Company. This beautiful replica also comes from Farnborough and can be seen in displays all over the country. Probably the most well-known aircraft in service with the RAF between the wars was the Hawker Hart, its many variants being in service from 1928 to 1939. The last biplane fighter to go into service with the RAF was the Gloster Gladiator, a four-gun fighter which gained fame in epic fights against the Luftwaffe in Norway and more than held its own in the Middle East. Three sea gladiators gained fame as faith, hope and charity, being Malta's sole defence for three critical weeks against all that the Italian Air Force could send against them. Naval types will recognise the torpedo-carrying fairy swordfish or stringback. World War II aircraft need little introduction. The Spitfires and Hurricanes were the heroes of the Battle of Britain and fought on all fronts. The Mosquito, originally designed for fast reconnaissance, became a potent fighter bomber. Too late for operational use in the war, the Lincoln bomber was in squadron service from 1945 to 1955 and is still in use with Signals Command. Four Shackletons of Coastal Command head a flypast of aircraft of operational command, including the Argosy, Britannia, Comets 2 and 4, Canberra, Valiant, Victor, Vulcan, Javelin, Lightning and Sea Vixen. The fitting climax was the demonstration of the revolutionary attack fighter, the Hawker P-1127, able to take off and land vertically, thus opening up exceptional tactical possibilities, being operational from any unprepared ground. As we enter the space age, the Royal Air Force celebrated 50 years of military aviation, only 59 years after the very first aeroplane took wing.